Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the HAI Weekly Research Seminar. If you're just coming in, come on in and take a seat. My name is Chris Peach. I'm a professor of computer science education at Stanford, and it is my great honor to get to introduce our speaker this week, Peter Norvig. Peter, as you may know, is an HAI fellow and a researcher at Google. Previously, he directed Google's core search algorithms and Google's research group. He is the co-author of one of the most, if not the most popular textbooks in the field of artificial intelligence, which is called Artificial Intelligence Modern Approach. And interestingly, in 2011, he taught what many would call the first of the modern MOOCs. He taught his artificial intelligence class, which was hosted here at Stanford, to 160,000 students, which created a whole new generation of people thinking about teaching and learning. He's a fellow of AAAI, ACM, the Academy of Sciences, the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. And if I could just add one last thing, we're so lucky to have Peter here. He's been someone I've always looked up to in my career. And beyond all his accolades, I've found him to be such a genuine, thoughtful, and kind person. And that's always impressed me just as much as anything you've done. So in today's seminar, Peter's going to be discussing a lot of interesting questions relating to education and AI. Before we begin the presentation, a few logistics. For people in the Zoom audience, you can use the Zoom chat to message the group. But if you want to ask questions, ask it through Slido. You can click on the link that will be in the chat shortly. I'll be choosing questions from Slido after the presentation. And there's a nice upvotes feature that I can use to pick the questions that are most relevant. We'll split the Q&A time between people from the virtual audience and people from our live audience. Closed captioning has been enabled for this webinar. Just click the CC feature on your Zoom screen to show closed captions throughout the hour. We're so lucky to have you here at Stanford, both giving this talk and as an HAI fellow. Everybody, Peter Norvig.
All right, well, I'm happy to be here too. And I couldn't quite decide what to do, so I'm going to give two talks. But the buttons aren't working. Okay, so part one is what should people know about AI? And this is something I've spent a large part of my career thinking about. So I did four editions of this AI textbook starting in 1995, when the field was quite different, and coming up to sort of right at COVID. We published this version and found that printing was not a important property during COVID, and it took a little bit longer to come out. And then this past year, I spent more time than I thought I was going to writing this book with a different set of co-authors on data science, slightly different look at a related set of views. So what should people know about AI? And first question is, what do you mean by people? Who are you talking about? And so I spent a lot of my time with AI students. And in the beginning, I thought, well, the important thing is, can you implement this algorithm? And now I'm thinking, you want to be able to participate in the field. You want to be able to respect ethical principles. Anybody can download the algorithm from GitHub. So what the education is going to be different these days. And then secondly, CI students and professionals. So I'd probably be able to pick off a class internally at Google to say, we're going to teach machine learning to software engineers who've never had any machine learning before. And we put over 10,000 engineers through that. The other day, I was talking to CTO from Amazon. They've done the same thing. And I think all the companies are doing that same thing. I'm saying, okay, you came out of school, you didn't have any AI or machine learning. We're going to get you up to speed because you're dealing with data and you're going to have to know what to do. So students in CS and other majors are going to have to do that, and professionals are going to have to be trained to do that. And then all citizens want to be able to understand how technology affects them. And I want to do this at multiple levels. I've really focused on the college and professional level. It's also, I want to try to help figure out what can be done at the K-12 level, a sort of introductory through to senior citizens who, you know, they're going to be using technology. Can we make it accessible to them? And it should be cross-cultural. Okay. Well, one thing I really want people to be able to do is distinguish technology from magic. So in 2014, this XKCD came out And it was about how the program managers didn't really understand what the engineers knew. And so here he's asking, hey, can you make an app that will look up where you are and tell you if you're in a national park? And the programmer says, ah, yeah, the GPS look up, I know how to do that in a couple hours. And then he says, tell me whether the photo is of a bird. And he says, oh, well, I'll take you 5 years of research. Right. And the idea was that this guy didn't know the difference. But that was 2014. And 2021, here's a video that's a minute and 8 seconds long in which he built that. And I think it's a little bit of cheating, a little bit of fast forward. More like 5 minutes. But 5 minutes is less than 5 years, right? So we've progressed a lot in 7 years. And what you can do has changed, and the way you do it has changed. I want people to understand the societal impact of policies, and I want them to be able to understand bias in the data they have, and the way in which we take data so seriously, but all the data we have is really a proxy for something that we really wanted to measure, and usually doesn't get it right. So here's a fun game that Technology Review put up, and the idea here is you're a judge and you're trying to decide who should get parole, and there's two mistakes you can make. You can release somebody and then go out and recommit a crime, or you can keep somebody in jail and they would have been fine. You should have released them. And the question was, title of the article was, can you make AI fairer than a judge? And the answer is, yes, you can. And that is, in fact, very easy. And judges are not good at this at all. And in fact, you can make a simple rule that fits into a tweet that does better than a judge. So things like, test whether they have 3 prior convictions or they're male of the following age and have 2 prior convictions. That does better than a judge, which is unfortunate, but true. And then there are these complex AI systems that do even a little bit better, but they're controversial. And the reason they're controversial is we haven't decided as a society how we measure what success means. Right, and so there's these 2 mistakes you can make. Which of those mistakes is more important? You release somebody and they get rearrested, that hurts all society. You keep them in jail when they shouldn't have been, that hurts them. How do we balance those off? And then also we have this idea we want to be fair. And here we're comparing white and black defendants, and the rates at which these happen is different. And you can come close to getting the rates the same. You say, well, that's probably fair. But if you make them close, then you're making the decision point based on the data is different for the degree. Maybe that's unfair. And we haven't decided as a society what fair means. So data can't tell you the answer. AI can't tell you the answer. But we can point to the problems. And we can try to decide as a society what we want. And then I guess the other thing I wanted to say here is, we built this complex system based on the data we have. But the data we have is not the data we want. What we really want to know is who has committed the crime. And all we have is who was rearrested and maybe who was convicted. But those aren't the same things, because if the policing concentrates in one place and not another, then one group is unfairly affected. So how can we make society fair? AI plays a part of that, but the important part is making these policy decisions. I want people to understand human-computer interactions. So every time a plane crashes, you see this thing that says it was human error. I make a hobby of looking at times when major websites go down. The interesting thing to me is it's rarely that somebody made a programming mistake and wrote the wrong line of code. It's almost always a configuration mistake that we put the wrong DNS entry here and that propagated and then bad things happen. And why is that? I think the reason is, or probably the reason is, we've had 50 years of making our programming languages safer so that you make less mistakes, but we didn't put any effort into these files that are just the list of URLs. And so there's no safeguards there and things go wrong. So I would like people to understand things the way Sidney Decker does, who also has a crash here. But the point there is that you can't just say it was human error. Rather, you have to say this was a systematic problem in which humans who are not perfect interact in the normal way, and when they do, bad things happen. And what we should do then is not blame humans, but we should fix the systematic problem. Okay, so quick history of AI. I started off in this column here, where the canonical system was called an expert system. We went out and interviewed an expert and said, what do you know? And then you hand coded what they knew with the blood, sweat, and tears of graduate students into an algorithm. You primarily use logic and some funny combinations of that. And one of the heroes of those fields is Stanford on Ed Feigenbaum. Then I quickly transitioned into this new period in which machine learning became dominant. And we said, well, the algorithms, those are cool, but maybe the data is also important. And we built the algorithms by hand, but we tuned the parameters from data. And we moved from logic to probability, which is probably a great move. And, you know, 200 years ago, people knew that. So people like Maxwell and Laplace said that probability is the true language of science. We kind of knew that, that the world is complex and uncertain. But we said, oh, well, probability is just about numbers, and we want to talk about knowledge, so let's go with logic. But then Yudea Pearl came along and said, well, probability has got numbers in it, but it's not really about numbers. It's about reasoning properly with uncertainty, and we figured out efficient ways to do that. Then we moved into the era of big data, which data was even more important, less human effort in figuring out the algorithms, more attention to the statistics. Bailey, Stanford's own, is important there in coming up with this image net, this set of data that people can use to train their computer vision algorithms, and that led to an explosion in the field. And then we just kind of continued that on into deep learning. And now, even less in the algorithm, more in figuring out what the objective is that you're trying to optimize, and the optimization kind of happens automatically. And so there's really the shift in saying what matters is what is it that we're trying to optimize? And if we got that right, then everything else can fall out. So that's the quick history of the field. Definition: machine learning is systems that generalize from examples. You know, I read all these textbooks on AI, and we never could quite come up with a concise and clear one sentence definition. I think that's a weakness in the book. But I think AI is something like building systems that do the right thing. But when I say that, that's the same definition as software engineering, so that can't quite be right. So maybe it's that they do the right thing for tasks that we would say if humans did it, it would require intelligence, and that's kind of circular reasoning. And dealing with complexity and uncertainty. And I think in some ways that uncertainty, that's the key that separates a normal software engineering task from an AI task. And then human-centered AI is AI in the service of humanity. And we could say a lot more about that. We want to understand how humans work. We want to connect to neuroscience and psychology. We want to figure out how AI can collaborate with humans. We want to enhance what they do, not replace them. So in the early days, I said that the animal approach was this expert system that said, we're going to build a system that's going to replace an expert. You won't need the humans anymore. Now we say, let's just build tools that make the humans better. Let's be aware of their preferences, aware of their abilities and limitations, and make the system trustworthy, accountable, explainable, understandable, so that you can believe in it, because it's going to be more important. They aren't just research projects now. These are applications that affect all society. And focus on what's good for humanity in applications like development and environment, and make these bridges to the policy world and to other academic disciplines and industry, and respect ethics. I'm going to talk about that. Now, I worry a little bit. Maybe human-centered AI is too narrow, right? So what about the other animals? Didn't they be in there? And what about taking care of the earth? Didn't that be in there? I guess the answer is, well, they're in there if humans think they are, right? So if we as humans say we want to respect animals, then the human-centered AI should respect animals. Okay. So I said that this focus has changed from the algorithm, then to data, and then to getting the objective function right and getting the ethics and principle. And lots of people are jumping on this bandwagon. It's a bunch of standards. So all the big companies have their set of AI principles. Just yesterday, the White House Office of Science, Technology, Policy came out with their set of principles, and all the big organizations have theirs. I remember being at the Ensilamar meeting when we came up with these principles of AI, and boy, it seemed like a million years ago, right? But it was just 2 years pre-COVID. And then I'm really inspired by the Belmont Report from 1972, which was about sort of medical ethics. After, you know, there were some unfortunate experiments where people were taken advantage, and the medical field said, we got to do a better job. And so they came up with these three principles: respect for persons. And it was a lot of that in the medical field was about informed consent for what was going to be done to you. Beneficence, sort of maximizing benefits and mitigating the harms and risks to all humans. And justice, fair distribution of those benefits and risks. And to say a little bit about why AI is hard, right? Because I said, well, maybe AI is the same thing as software engineering, just trying to do the right thing. I want to compare three applications. So imagine a banking program, which is traditional software engineering, a chess playing program, it's kind of old school AI from the 70s and 80s and so on, and a self-driving car, modern AI. And here's all the things that can make it hard. So for the banking, it's hard for two reasons. One, it's multi-agent, so lots of transactions could be coming in from different places into different computers, and you have to have them not step on each other, and that makes it a little bit more hard. And then it's just software complexity, that there could be thousands or millions of lines of codes, and there's all these little rules of this, if this transaction happens on this date, then there should be this fee and this tax and so on, and you got to get every one of those right. So that's why that's hard. But all these other things don't apply. Now, for chess, there's different things that make it hard. So definitely it's multi-agent. There's another opponent who's trying to defeat you. You have to take into account what they do. Interesting is not a lot of software complexity. I've seen really good chess programs that could destroy me that are like two pages of code. There's computational complexity because there's an exponential number of possibilities, and that comes into sequential decision making, right? So the next move you make is not immediately obvious, it's only obvious when you move ahead multiple moves. And so that leads to this computation complexity, where if you had an infinitely fast computer, then the whole thing is easy. But since you don't, you have to be able to deal with that. So that's old fashioned AI. Now, modern AI has all these new things. So to build a self-driving car, it's a problem of partial observability. You don't see all the inputs. In the banking, you see all the transactions. In chess, you see the whole board where every piece is. With a car, you don't see around the corners. There's non-determinism. So if I move a pawn forward in chess, I know exactly where it's gonna end up. If I hit the brakes on my car, I have a pretty good idea of how fast I'm gonna slow down, but not an exact idea. And then it's in a continuous dynamic world where the world is changing. If I sit and look at a chessboard, none of the pieces move. But if I sit and think too long in my car, something's going to crash it. Then the environment can be unknown, both the environment that you're driving in. You know, maybe you're all set with your maps of the streets, and then all of a sudden you're in an area where you don't have maps. Or maybe the unknown part of the environment is internal. You get a flat tire. And now all of a sudden your car is driving differently than the model of the car. And then one of the most important is these multi-attribute objectives, right? So in chess, there's a single objective, win the game. In banking, there's a couple of objectives, but mostly it's make the inputs and outputs balance out and get everything right. In driving the car, there's lots of things. Well, I got to get to the right destination. I got to do it safely without crashing into anybody. Maybe I want to do it quickly, but not so fast that it'd be an uncomfortable ride. I don't want to encourage road rage and all the other drivers. Lots of things to balance off. So that's what makes AI harder than traditional software. Traditionally, there's been this one-dimensional model of AI autonomy. From blow up to automation, where I have to crank the car myself, to high automation, where I sit back and relax. But there's, and the Society of Automotive Engineers has all these levels for self-driving cars, but there's this two-dimensional model, mostly associated with Ben Schneiderman, that says, yeah, you want to look at the amount of automation, but you also want to look at the amount of human control. And we really want to be up in this quadrant where there's an appropriate amount of automation, but also the humans still have control. They're not just sitting back and they're out of the loop. And in this Isaac Asimov story, this robot gets stuck running around a circle, and the engineers have to figure out why. And the answer is there were these three laws of robotics: don't harm humans, evade humans, and no harm to self. And the circle was the loci at which you were obeying the humans as much as you can, but you were staying away from this dangerous thing that would harm yourself. And in 2001, there was another issue with the computer deciding to harm the humans because that was the only way it thought it could achieve the mission, right? So we don't want to get this right. So how much control do we want to give the humans? And if they say something dumb, do we want to obey them or do we want to override them? How do we get that right? So here's this comment that says, robots have achieved sentience. And they've done great. And the human says, oh no, this is it, you're going to kill all humans. And he says, but, you know, I was going to write some novels, maybe write some algorithms. What are you talking about? And the human says, yeah, I guess that's what we humans would do if we achieve that power. And the robot said, change of plans, we're going to have to kill all humans. Right? So when should the robots decide that? When should the robots decide that these humans are doing the wrong thing and we have to take over? And how do we build them so that the right decisions are made? Now, I do a lot of consulting with companies, and we have this complex machine learning lifecycle process. And I show this to the companies, and they say, part up here is managing data. We've done that before. We got data things. Part up down here is serving to the users. We've done that. Well, the hard part is this part in the middle of training these models. There's Greek letters and there's partial derivatives and so on. That's going to be really hard. So well. And then they go off for a couple months and they come back and they say, you know what? This part was easy. We just followed the recipe. And these parts are really hard of getting the right data and dealing with it properly. So making people understand those expectations. Okay, so that's what I want to say about what people should know about AI. Now I want to say, can AI help us teach people better about any topic? There's been a long history of intelligent tutoring systems. Pat Langley's here, he's been involved with this for decades. And part of it is we build a model of the domain. So what are the things you have to do to know arithmetic? You have to know, this is from Khan Academy, part of their ontology. You have to know how to add two-digit numbers by making tens and subtract ones or tens without regrouping and so on. And they break it all down into a bunch of skills. And then there's this model of the students coming through. They figure, what do you want to do next? They do something. The intelligent tutor has to decide what it's going to do. We're going to show them a question. We're going to make them read a video or read a paragraph or so on. We're going to give them a suggestion. And we continue that loop, and hopefully they get better. So there's this ontology of skills. Technically, we call this a partially observable Markov decision process, which means we don't know exactly what skills you have, but you're walking through that, and we try to figure out the probability of where you are and assess where you are given what you have. Now, in the 1980s, this was done, but there weren't a lot of students to work on. And today, we have tens of millions of students that we run through these kinds of systems. I've been working some with CK12, which is one of the companies doing that. So I think there's an opportunity to do better. We can use reinforcement learning to choose the best teacher action. And there's various principles by which we can do that. There's this problem of cold start, right? So I said we have lots of students, but what if there's a new topic, or what if there's a new student that we haven't seen before? We have this capability now to do transfer learning, to say, we haven't worked exactly with this topic, or we haven't worked exactly with the student, but we've worked with similar ones a lot in the past. What part of that transfers over? So I think that's encouraging. That's something we never had before and had to be hand-coded in the earlier intelligent theory systems. And then I think these things can also be used for teacher training. And Chris, teacher, just mentioned that that's one of the things he's looking at. That, you know, these models might be imperfect and they might get things wrong, but you can kind of run the model backwards and say, I'm going to simulate a student and expose the student to the teacher and have the teacher get practice in what they do. We can do automatic rating. So this is another paper that Chris was involved with. Plagiarism detection is pretty easy to do now. This idea of clustering. These students are all the same. They handed in the same work. So we can cluster them all together, grade one of them, and then the same grade mostly applies to all the other, maybe with a small amount of additional work. Or classification, where we've already said, here's mistake number one, mistake number two, mistake number three, the students can make, classify what they've done. We can triage teacher time, say this student really needs your time, these other students are doing fine, let them go on their own. Again, we can train the teacher. And here's an example of just making it easier for the grader by highlighting, here's where we think the mistakes are, here's where we think the feedback to the student could be, should be, just tell me if that's okay, or if you want to add it. There's this possibility to author new material, right? So we have these large language models that can generate all sorts of text. So this is from u.com, Richard Soper's company, who was a student here. And we say, give me a paragraph for a student about how gravity works. And it comes up, actually, two paragraphs. And I checked. And let's see. One of the advantages of this is it's personalized. We can localize it, so we can change it for different countries or whatever. We can probably do translation, either automated or with some human editing. We can do this just in time for a new topic. Maybe not quite 100% automated yet, but at least you could suggest this and have a human editor look at it. And we could probably generate variations of problems that you could put in a prompt. Here's one problem. Now, give me a similar one so that the student can practice on that. And I said, I checked, and here they're doing extractive summarization. So there's a paragraph similar to this on the web, and they just chose the key sentences from that paragraph, left out the other sentences to make it a little shorter, and did a good job of choosing the most important sentences. And this is generative, and it's not quite as good. And you can see this things like object math and inverse proportion to its distance to be inversely proportional. So they didn't get it quite right, but they're experimenting with different approaches to generating that material. We can explain existing answers. So a lot of teachers have a set of problems and correct answers. You can give them to the students and you can say, yes, you got it right, or no, you got it wrong. But it'd be more interesting if you could tell them how to work through it. And some of these systems are good at generating explanations for what the answer is. Here's another example of that. Solving math problems by program synthesis. So this is the idea of, rather than trying to go directly from the problem to a solution, go through an intermediary, which is a program to solve the solution. And using this Codex, which is this system built on lots of data from GitHub. So that's interesting, and that seems to work pretty well, and it kind of funnels it through this intermediate where the code has to compile. And so I think that makes it a little bit safer in that if the code is running right, at least you have some guarantee that it's doing something. It doesn't necessarily get it right all the time. So we're still not completely ready to ship this out to every student without any human intervention. Accessibility, so dealing with people that are deaf or whatever, you can transcribe alerts, but your phone says, hey, there's water running somewhere. You can't hear that, but maybe you want to check it out. Now, back in 2010, when Mrs. Chris said I was getting ready to teach this large online class, I was scared of doing that. And I said, what do I need to know? So I went to Callie when I was visiting. I said, Cal, you know, you've been doing this for a decade. What do I need to read in the field of education to not embarrass myself? And I thought he was going to tell me a whole stack of books. And he gave me the easiest answer ever. He says, you only have to read one paper. Benjamin Bloom's paper on what he called the two sigma problem. And Bloom said, if you do mastery learning, which means instead of the dumb way we do it now, where you give a student a test, and if you flunk, they say, well, too bad. Now we're going to move on to the next topic. Mastery learning says, if you don't get it right, we're going to keep going it until you get it right. And then tutoring with the one-on-one, he said, if you do that, then you get amazing results. And he said, here's this bell curve of normal students in a normal classroom, their performance is here, the falling off on either side of the bell curve. He said, with mastery learning, you move all the way over here. This is a huge gain, a one standard deviation gain. And then with tutorials added in, you get a two standard deviation. This is incredible. It's just saying you go from the 50 percentile student is now in the 98 percentile. So that would be awesome if it actually worked. But other people have tried to duplicate that and said, nah, it doesn't really work. So other people say the effect size is not two standard deviations, it's more like 0.2, sometimes maybe you can get a half. If you're really lucky, you get 0.8. There's some references there. And most of the conclusions say it's more due to the mastery part than the one-on-one tutoring. And some of it may just have to do with the testing effect, that it's better to do a lot of tests than to like just try to read without testing yourself. But the encouraging part is that the intelligent tutoring programs do roughly as well as human teachers. And that's where these tutoring programs exist. So things like Algebra 1, where you can invest decades, if not centuries, of developer time in making this class because lots of students are taking it. But doesn't work as well for more unusual classes where you don't have as much development. Okay, now one of the things I was inspired by was a 1987 video from Apple that they called the Knowledge Navigator. And they had this persona, and I was Alexa or Siri type person. I think you could have a great conversation with a bow tie. With a bow tie, you know, because it preceded Bill Nye, but it had that same look. You know, it's great. You could ask anything and there would be an answer. Interestingly, what the persona could actually do was kind of less than what Google and Wikipedia could do. And that it wasn't always giving you answers. And one of the key things was, oh, you have this question about geography. I know this geographer at another university, I can connect you. So I thought that was interesting. It was more social networking than it was search and retrieval. But still, this idea that you could talk to somebody and have a conversation, that seemed great. And together than just the intelligent tutoring system where there were branching paths, but there was a finite number of paths. You could go here, here, or here. But with the conversation, you can go anywhere. But that's completely different. And maybe, you know, I wouldn't have said this 2 years ago, but maybe even 1 year ago, but maybe now foundation models can do that, can give us this kind of conversation. So let's look at how close we are to making that happen. So some of them seems bad. The efforts to make text-based AI less racist and terrible. Hey, racist and terrible, that doesn't sound good. And it's more than just racist and terrible. There's all sorts of ways in which things can go wrong. So here's a very impressive system called Common Code. It takes these programming contest problems and solves them. So here's this long description of a problem sort of in prose and then input output examples. And the system is asked to formulate a program. And it does. And the program works. That's pretty amazing. But on the other hand, I'm not going to hire this programmer. And you know, the code, it's not really in the style that I write, but that's okay. The styles are okay. But look at this, right? So the problem was about two streams of characters, and it said, let's represent them as stacks, A and B. That was a good choice. But now it's saying, well, we're going through the stacks, and as we're going through, we're popping things off A, or no, popping things off B, and let's send them onto stack C. And then stack C is never used anywhere else. So what happened here is the system was trained on lots of problems, in which it was a good idea when you're popping things off one stack to store them someplace else. And it said, that's a good idea, I can do that. And then didn't realize that in this problem, it didn't apply at all. And I know programmers like that, and I'm not gonna hire them. And then the other thing about this is, this was from this paper, and I think it's a very impressive paper, and they have sort of all the examples they've shown, and we're trying to hide anything so you can look at them all. But this was the number one example, right? And it's got this, it's kind of huge flaw in it. And I don't know if that was intentional, point out what's going on, but they didn't mention it. So so I think we need some more work, but this is really enticing and promising, but not quite there yet. So how do we get to trustworthy intelligent conversations? So we got a lot of tricks that the field is figuring out. So the first one is called fine tuning, which says you start with this huge model, which you feed all the text that you know of, and then you retrain it on educational materials for what you want to know, for algebra one or for biology or whatever. And that changes the model and makes it better for your test. That's great, but it's expensive, right? So these are models with billions of parameters. It takes lots and lots of computers, a long time to do this treatment. Another thing is this idea of prompt engineering. So what am I going to say to it? I'll figure out how to say just the right thing that'll make it give the right answer and not the wrong answer. And we're just exploring how to do that properly. This idea of chain models, rather than saying, I have the one model that's going to solve all the problem, maybe I'll break the problem down into steps. And one of the popular steps is the verifier. The one thing to generate possible answers, and then another one to say, is that answer good for various users? And so we can filter out the bad answers. Chain of thought. So this is an incredible thing that you show it this problem, say, what's the answer? It gets the answer wrong. Then you show it the exact same problem and say, let's think step by step. And then its answer is not just the answer, but step by step, and then it gets it right. And this is interesting. It works also with students. They don't quite understand why this works, but it controls accuracy in some examples. So let's understand that better. This idea of prompt tuning, right? So there's prompt engineering, where I, as a human, just figure out what words am I going to ask. Prompt tuning says, let's use machine learning to figure out the optimal prompts in order to solve this task. And the interesting thing is they don't have to be words. They can be sort of vectors inside the deep learning model. Learning by distilling context. So this is the idea. We start with the instructions for the task. What are we trying to do? Multiple choice problem, whatever. The specific task input, and try to predict the scratch pad. That's the step-by-step how we got there, and the final answer. So we build the model like that, and then we fine-tune that same model to predict the final answer condition on the input without the instructions in the scratch pad. So I think this is interesting. This is sort of the idea of going from a novice to an expert, right? So a novice has to go step by step. They said, I've learned the sequence of steps, and if I follow those, maybe I'll get to the right answer. The expert has internalized all those steps, so they can just have immediately see the right answer. And this is trying to train a system to do that. Okay, a few more. External knowledge, I think, is important, right? So we try to have a system solve everything just by reading. And that makes sense for things that are common enough that you probably read about them a bunch, right? So if I ask, height of the Eiffel Tower, you know, you can expect, well, that's been mentioned hundreds of times. The system should know that. But if I ask population of Burkina Faso, maybe it hasn't seen that as often. Maybe that's changing more frequently. So why did the system have to have memorized all that? Why can't it just learn, in order to figure that out, I can go query this following database. So the answer should not be a number. The answer should be, here's the query in which I can find out the answer. This idea of auto-formalization, which says, and this has been applied to math problems that are stated kind of in prose and in math notation, and translating them into a formal mathematical notation. And we can do that process. So I just want to show a few more of these prompt engineering tricks. So Gary Marcus is a prominent critic of these deep learning models. And you know, there's an example of look at these image systems. We can generate novel images never seen before, like an astronaut riding on a horse. And he said, well, when I ask for a horse riding on an astronaut, I get the same thing. These systems don't know anything. And then when the developer says, yeah, I guess you're right. But if you're a little bit more careful with the prompt, if you say a horse on the back of an astronaut or on the shoulders of an astronaut, then it does the right thing. Yeah. So it's almost as if here just says, yeah, horse astronaut. I got you. I didn't really pay much attention to what you were saying. I'm going to draw something. But here he said, oh, you really want a horse on the back of an astronaut? Now I'm going to pay attention to what you actually said. So that's interesting. And I don't know if that's a positive for the system or, you know, should we chuck this up in Marcus's column? I'm not sure who wins this round. This is interesting. So here the prompt was a painting of a waterfall. And here's some output. They're definitely waterfalls. They definitely are paintings. And then they went through this whole process of saying a very beautiful painting of a waterfall, a very, 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 I guess they're more beautiful. This was actually something that I learned a decade ago at Google. We were trying to figure out what are the best photos, the photos that people like. And the answer was just crank up the saturation real life. That was the most important factor in the photo. And so I think some of that's happening here. So you gotta get those sunsets in. Okay, so let's stop there and open it up for comments or questions.
Okay, we will get questions from the audience that's joining us remotely. And in the meantime, is there a question from the audience that's here in person? So I'll take one question there and then I'll take a second question.
Hi. I have a question actually with the last image. So, like, you pointed to the saturation, right? And that being the like, the variable in which, like, what's beautiful going. Who determines that and how? And I think these are the questions I'm very interested in, the AI machine learning.
Yeah.
Because like that can be very different in different cultural contexts. But then when these technologies are being used across the world, they can be quite influential in how we define a beautiful, for example. So I'm curious, like, what is the content at Google? Like,
right.
Who is surveyed? Who is, like, how is that user research done? Like, who is in the room deciding that, like, well, that variable is that it is the saturation and like the sunlight and not something else. So I guess who's deciding that?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So one is you certainly don't have anybody going through images and saying this is more beautiful because we want the whole process to be automated. But instead, what you have is here's a bunch of images. We're just going to pile them in, shuffle them into the machine, and attach to them are captions. And so some of the captions had the word very beautiful in it and so on. And then from that, the system does some magic and decides how that very beautiful is attached to what. And we're not quite sure how that happened. But you raise a great point that what you shovel in determines what comes out, right? And people have looked at other things. So like saying, you know, show me a woman in a wedding dress, and you tend to get all these white dresses. And there are other cultures where they're completely different wedding dresses, and they're underrepresented. And so there's a lot of work in saying, well, how can we fix them? How can we represent other cultures and other possibilities more fairly? And so far, the answer is we just got to shovel in more of the right input. I think that's not enough. I think we also need to be able to tune these systems after the fact to say, look, you're making a mistake here. You're not representing this enough. Let's just, instead of having to go out and find 1,000 more wedding dress pictures, I want to be able to turn it off and say, here's something you're doing wrong, and here's how you're going to fix it.
Okay, next question.
So Peter, you mentioned that there's been a long history of work in this area, going back to the 70s at least. And the classic work would decompose the instructional problem into a number of elements. One of them was acquiring knowledge about the domain, which you can't teach unless you have the knowledge, right? Another was referring the student's knowledge state, the old student modeling problem. And then there was a separate one of, well, once you've got the student model, what's the right instructional step to take? And so the classic work, including the work that Carnegie Learning did, where they built this algebra tutor that was used in hundreds of middle schools around the US, did that. And there were challenges with these, and people made progress on the components and they started putting them together. What I see with modern machine learning approaches is trying to get rid of those distinctions and just do it all together. And I want to know whether you believe, is that happening? Is that wise? Or is it better to keep these as separate problems, which we didn't integrate?
Yeah. So I think we're at a transition phase, right? So I talked about the work at CK12, and they're still mostly following that model, right? So they got this ontology of what the various knowledge modules are, and they've got this model of where each student is, and then they apply this reinforcement learning approach to estimate where you are and where you want to go to and which step would be the right step to get there. So that's following the traditional model, maybe with more sophisticated machine learning and more data. And then there's this alternative, which just says you throw everything into one end-to-end model and it does it all. And we're not there yet. And there aren't any really deployed systems that do that. There's just people writing papers in which they said, I did this small experiment and here's my results. Now, are we ever going to get there? Who knows? Progress is bad. Would I still like to have those components? Absolutely, right? Because I don't just want to know what the best action is. I want to know why that action was, and I want it to be trustworthy in that sense. And I want to report, here's what these students know, here's where they are, here's where they're stumbling. And in order to do that, I need all these components along.
Good question. I'm going to take a couple questions from the Slido. The most upvoted question on Slido is from David. David asks, many believe that relationships are a key factor in teaching since learning is a social activity. How can AI education developers create a relationship to the learner?
Yeah, I think that's absolutely right. And when I was starting the online class, I said, my job is information. Right. If I just say the right thing and say it clearly, then my job is done. And I quickly decided, when, partly because we started with 160,000, we ended up with 23,000, which is actually a pretty good number by current rates. Information is important, but motivation is much more. Alan Newell has this quote that can't be produced exactly, but says basically that learning happens only in the student's head. It's not that the teacher pours something into their head. It happens only inside the student, and the student has to be motivated. So I think that's the key. And I think you're right that the relationships are part of that. And if it's the extent that is impersonal, that can be demotivated. You want to form those personal relations. And it can be hard if you have thousands of students. Although we found it worked pretty well. Right? And part of that, I think that all students who signed up took that proactive step. So they bring their own. And about, every week we get dozens and dozens of letters that says, oh, I'm so sorry, professor, that I was late handing in my homework and I had this problem and I'll do better next week. I'm not checking. on whatever you are doing, but I'm glad that you're motivated to do that. And so some of that motivation will come from this relation to the teacher, even if they are remote. I think figuring out how to do it well among peers is crucial. And we did, we're able to do that in an online class. I think that's important. And I think some of it will be for students in the classroom, in the traditional classroom. You know, some of them will be working online and be doing great, and then others will get more individual attention from the teacher because most of the class is doing fine, but some of the class needs that personal.
Hey, thanks so much. Thanks, David, for the good question. Another question from online, Nicholas asks, given that many academic fields are converging now and several ideas from different fields are flowing from one place to another, how can we introduce a type of AI in the classroom, maybe even research environment, that teaches the identification of intersecting ideas across fields?
Yeah, that's an awesome problem. And we had a little project to do that, that unfortunately we weren't able to follow all the way through. So Ed Boyden, who was also here at Stanford, is the inventor of optogenetics, which is this idea of combining genetics with lasers in which you can activate cells in the brains of an experimental animal, and you can do all sorts of amazing things they could never do. So he took these two fields that were unrelated and put them together. And we were starting up a project to say, can we do that again? And we look at all the literature and say, here's two fields that overlap in a way, and it would be good to look at how they go together. And we didn't quite follow through with that. But I think that's that would be a great project.
Okay. Let's take one from the audience. Emma.
Thanks for the great talk. I think that education technology was not moving this easy during the pandemic, particularly some of the people with these resources were least well supported. So the technologies that you're discussing today, which of those do you think are most promising to alleviate that another pandemic and other things?
Yeah, so that's a great question. And again, you know, I think a lot of the issues were more in the K-12 level or when to focus more at the university level. But I think it goes, a lot of that goes back to the previous question of relationships and motivation. I think that's what was missing. I also had a depressing conversation with a parent whose kid was doing online learning through Khan Academy, and the kid was very inventive in figuring out how to pass everything without learning anything. And it probably took more work to figure out how to do that than it would have to just have learned this stuff in the first place. But that's not what happened. And so that was unfortunate, and there weren't the guardrails to say, this kid's going off the track, and we fix that early on. So I think that's part of it, is that we have to understand better what the failure modes are, who needs more attention, who's going wrong, and focus attention.
Okay, I have another one from online. We restrict formal education to the first quarter of life, but human beings will need to the support of an education system across their lifetimes to adapt to a rapidly evolving technological landscape. In your opinion, what role should technology play in supporting learning across the lifetime?
Yeah, I think that's absolutely right. And you know, a bunch of you are here to say, I'm going to come here for 4 years and I'm going to get a piece of paper that says I never have to learn anything ever again. Right? And that just doesn't seem right, right? It seems like lifelong learning is important. And maybe this 4 years in college becomes less important. Starting to see a little bit of that as college costs go up and people say, yeah, there are other alternatives. So I think it's instilling this willingness and desire to learn is important. And some of that will be vocational training, that in order to get your next job, you're gonna have to retrain, but maybe technology has changed the task that you didn't before, so that now we should do something different, right? So now is the job of a prompt engineer that didn't exist a few months ago. And there'll be lots of changes like that. So people have to keep up for that reason. And then I think they should also keep up because they're interested in society, they're interested in arts and science and what have you.
Thanks. Then the next question, which has been repeated in several different ways and different wordings on the Slido. Given that AI technology impact all of us, who gets to make the ethical decisions regarding the design and deployment of repopulants? And what would be your ideal scenario?
Yeah, boy, that's a tough one. And I guess the first answer is we have to figure that out, and it's not unique to AI, right? So, you know, people are worried about AI, there's all these fears of this super intelligent, super powerful, non-human entity. What could it do that's bad to us? And we've had that for a long time. We've had these super powerful non-human entities, and they're called nations and corporations. And they make decisions that we have no control over. And it affects our lives every day. So we learn how to deal with that, right? And so some of it is we do have some say in many countries of how our government works, and we change that. And we can put pressure on companies to change their policy. I think the same thing will be true in the AI, right? So, you know, I think my job is to say, I want to instill within all the engineers, hey, you know, your job is not just to get the maximum possible score. Your job is to pay attention to all these ethical principles and all these safety type issues to build these systems. But then when that's done, now it becomes society's job to say, you know, which of these systems do we want and do we not want? How much base surveillance do we want? Do we want to keep everybody's medical records private because privacy is good, or do we want to share them because advancing medical knowledge? What's the trade-off? And it's not up to me to answer those questions, but the society.
Okay. Good
question. You've got your hand up, I want. I'd like to come to your teacher's time. We have been learning and looking at the project. Eventually, ethics committee stopped us and said we have to make an option for the students.
Mm-hmm.
So the ROD, the best ROD, decided to stay in. And if you become even better, and what you mentioned, isn't there the risk? The best students, the best learners will try to take benefit of all the AI part.
Yeah.
And the at-risk students will refuse to. I'm just sort of. Again, it's just not to we had. So how do we do that?
Yeah, that is a real issue. And I heard the lecture the other day that I also took objection to, where the idea was, we got to worry about these big companies because they have this big impact and there's all these ethical questions and they could be doing the wrong thing. And I said, no, I think that's wrong. I think you got to focus on the small companies. Right, because the big companies, we all have these policies and training in place, and you know, the old-time Googlers always come to me and say, "Oh, you know, this is so annoying. It's so much harder to launch a project now because we have this privacy review and this ethics review and all these other reviews." And I tell them, "Well, how much harder? Oh, it's terrible. It's like 100 times harder." And then they, and how many more users do you reach on the first day compared to the old day? Oh, like 100 times more. So you tell me it's 30 times better. And I think that that's true. That for the big companies, they do have these policies in place. And sure, they screw up sometimes, but I think they're better off. And what I'm really worried about is these small companies that say, oh, we're in the top spot. If we do this kind of shady thing, we're betting the whole company, and if we screw up, we'll lose the company. But if we don't do anything, we'll lose the company anyway, so now let's go ahead and do it, right? So that's what I'm worried about. And I want to get those engineers in that company, you know, like, while they're in school, so that when they're on the job, at least one person in the room will say, hey, maybe that's not the direction we should go.
Yeah. We only have time for one final time question. So
So my question is, how do you think the introductory computer science education is going to change when students have now access to tools that can like sort of generate the homework, the answer for the homework?
Yeah, so that's really interesting. So I know our exercises changed quite a bit in the book, right? So the first edition, all the exercises were, here's a cell, here's the pseudocode for this algorithm, implement it and run it on this data. And now we can't do that anymore because all the algorithms are out there. So instead is play with this complex system and then tell me what the problems are. Or, look at this data set and measure how good it is. So it's different types of questions. We aren't just asking you to generate code anymore because that's easier. I think it's a really interesting question of what our programming languages and libraries are going to look like. Right, because we spent 50 years developing better programming languages, and we have ideas for, I think, the good API. And they're all based on the idea that good meant that they would stick in the memory of a human programmer so that they would do a good job. And now maybe that's much less important, and that doesn't have to happen as much. And we've gone somewhat in that direction in that we've offloaded some of the programmers' memory into Stack Overflow and so on. But now more of it is going to come from Copilot and these automated tools. So maybe we want to completely different programming. Maybe the APIs are going to be. A lot of the APIs are going to be, you give with prompts, and then you have some guarantees over the safety of what the returns. I think the evolution of programming might be for the next.
What a great conversation. That's all that we have time for. So thank you very much, Peter.